Reinhard. What is going on, everybody? Thanks again for joining us here on Expanded Perspectives with me, Cam Hale. And of course, as always, the man I introduce every week, King of the Dakar Malimoto, Kyle Filson.
How's it going, everybody? I'm proud to be here and glad to be here in studio, despite all the wildfires that are going around this area.
That's true. Yeah.
Excuse me. I got to clear my coat because of all the smoke. But yeah, a lot of people have messaged us. There's been fires down here like crazy in the same county that we live in.
It's all around us right now.
It's mostly north of us, a little bit north, a little bit east. But yeah, I mean, there's already 1,000 acres. Now, I know this is nothing compared to like the wildfires in California. No. But nonetheless, I mean, it's just terrible to see people's houses and stuff burnt up.
And the way the wind's blowing today and it's bouncing and I mean, it's moving quickly out through there. The guys are working hard. In fact, a bunch of the guys that I worked with took a bunch of our equipment up this afternoon and were pushing down fire breaks and had a bunch of our water. Like we have some VACCONs, big vacuum trucks. Basically, you got to imagine a giant shop vac mounted on the back of a truck that has water, like almost kind of like car wash wands and stuff on it. They can change them out where they've got water hose so you can fill that thing full of water. It's got giant tubs, too. So they're out there fighting and blasting the grass fires. So a bunch of our guys was fighting fires right along beside the firefighters this afternoon.
Well, I heard it started because of a guy just building some fence with like an arc welder, throws a spark, wind gets up, catches everything. You know, and the terrible part is just people just to this don't have a lack of care. Like even today, this afternoon, while the fires were going on, I was driving around doing my normal job and the car in front of me were at a light. I see him flick out a cigarette. I'm like, are you not aware of the fires? Or is it just, they just out of sight, out of mind? I don't care.
I don't think they think about it. I just don't believe it crosses their mind,
but it needs to.
Yeah. Should.
People's lives are destroyed.
Yeah.
Homes are destroyed. Yeah, you know, things like that over something simple. If you're going to smoke, just put it out in your car.
Yeah.
Right?
Would be easy enough.
You would think,
yeah. I got a question for you, Brad.
Sure.
Did you get drawn in with the videos that I sent you?
I did, yes. Like in the introduction, you were calling me the Malimoto King?
First place Malimoto, the Dakar Rally.
Yeah, I've been watching a lot of the Dakar Rally lately, and the Malimoto was in a particular portion of the Dakar Rally that I was unaware of. Now, I've been watching the Dakar off and on for years. I mean, it's a huge rally race, like, you know, cars, trucks, quads, motorcycles, stuff. But I had no idea about the new event called Malimoto.
And I don't know how long it's been in there. I just know that I'm eat up with watching the whole thing. What got me going, folks, is all you Australian listeners, y'all have a really badass rally racer named Toby Price. And that fella is a beast.
The guy is a beast.
He's a beast. You know, to get your neck broke and then come back and keep racing the Dakar. Yeah, that's... He's a monster. Yeah. So I'm not really sure. He doesn't, of course, do the Malimoto. I'm not really sure when all that started. But what we're talking about, for those of you that have no idea, most of you probably don't care, is the Dakar Rally. Okay, when did it start? Like 78, I believe.
1978. It used to go from like Paris, France to Senegal. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, to Dakar. And then they've changed it out of there, of course, due to security and all this stuff. To, I think, 08 is when they canceled it in 08, and I think they picked it up in 09, but now it's all in South America.
Right.
Is where it's held now. And all it is just super long sections of a race, like through the desert, through the mountains. I mean, it is a beating of a long-distance race. Now, it's not ran, of course, start to finish. There are kind of like stages where you ride a stage, and then there's different ways of going about it. But the Malimoto that we're talking about is, instead of having a crew with you, on the motorcycle and having, you know, guys and teammates, and if it breaks down, everybody pitches in, they get it fixed and go. You're allowed a box, basically, a little bit bigger than a footlocker. And everything that fits in that footlocker, this box, is all you can bring with you, including your tent. Now, of course, you can restock at the end of the night, but it has to fit all your tools and all the parts that you're going to need for that motorcycle at the end of that day or that stage. And then at the end of the night, when you're done with it and you get it all restocked and you pack it all up and lock it, the guys will come pick it up, the people that put on the race, and they will take it to the end of the next stage. So most of these Malimoto guys fix everything. Nobody can help you fix your bike.
Nobody can touch it.
Everything has to be in that box that you bring with you. You set up your own tent. You break it all down. You got your own food. You got your own everything. They literally race 18 days, and they get about 2 hours of sleep a night.
Yeah.
Is what they usually end up. So when the guys that race Malimoto is like the true,
it's the hardest
guys.
Way to do
it's
it.
It's the hardest way to do it. Yeah. And I meet up with it, man. I would never do it, but I love to watch other people do it.
Oh, well, yeah, I would never do it, but it does look fun, and I'm always impressed with people that can go through that type of turmoil.
Oh,
and just, struggle, because I, like, did you see some of the guys that they went through the whole race? They only had 2 days left, and then the motorcycle breaks.
Yeah, but yeah,
and just they're like, that's it.
It's an, it's
they don't
over.
Care.
Swing arms.
17 days
off of
in
it.
Doesn't matter.
Nope, you're out.
It's trashed.
You're done. It's over. Yeah,
and it's not your will. It's like the frame of the motorcycle broke from the vibration. Yeah. You're like, man,
it's
the guy's
crazy.
Like, oh, I think I'll just zip tie it.
Oh yeah, yeah. Saw,
and then he's like, and
guy.
Then I might use some duct tape, because he's like, I'm not quitting now. I don't.
Well,
care
he
what
said
happened.
He goes, I could weld it, but I have to break the whole bike down.
And
to
I'm too
weld
tired.
It. And he goes, it's going to take too long.
Yeah,
yeah. It's going to take too long. Well, I got something that's not going to take too long. What's not going to take too long is getting into these crazy stories that I've got for you, Philly.
All right, let's do
I
it.
I want you to listen to this, folks.
Sure.
I actually scoured. I spent some time on the interwebs this weekend digging deep to find some really interesting news stories, and I come across this from Cryptozoology News. And so...
Here we go.
Yeah. Well, here's what caught me. The headline has Neanderthal in it, okay? So right then, I'm like, oh, you now have my full attention. It said, Portugal woman encounters Neanderthal. She says a woman in Portugal, this is what it says, claims that her and her sister saw not one, but two of them.
In Portugal?
And now listen to this. Listen to this. This was from an 83-year-old woman. This place is Serra da Estrela is where it's at. That she said that her and her sister were taking care of cows, a herd of cattle, when they spotted two primitive men. Now, this, she says, happened back in 1939. She said she was 5 and her sister was 8. So I'm sure the dad or the mom and all of them said, hey, look, just sit here. If anything comes up to the cows, come get us, right? You know, just hang out right here. They were in a remote area in the Sierra de la Estrela when they say they saw two naked men speaking a totally strange language. Says then, this is what she says, then we saw them entering a cave. Now she says the next day they both, her and her sister, decided that they would go check it out, and they took their sheepdog with them. Now she said, now when we reached the cave, our dog did not want to go in. Says he kept growling, and my sister wanted to go back. Now we could smell smoke that appeared to be coming from the inside of the cave. Now she go later on, she says that they told her father what they had seen, and he became extremely aggravated with them. And he told them that he had already known about the existence of these people. And he goes on to tell them that they were the original people who survived in a few numbers and were still living in a primitive state. Now, she goes on to say that I remember him saying that they were only about a half of a dozen of them. So, six.
Yeah.
Left. Completely left. Now, she referred to them as the wild people. Now, she said that their skin had like a yellow tone to it and that they were naked is what she saw. I'm naked on that whole deal.
Poha.
Yeah.
Right? No.
I can only see it
in Portuguese, right?
Yeah. So, I don't know. Look, we've covered it whenever we talked about it, whenever the Russians found all this stuff.
Yeah, that was one of my favorite stories.
Yeah,
that
the
was
Almasty.
From like World War I. Yeah. They encountered what they said was a Neanderthal living in a cave. Remember, the guy shot it.
Well, you got to remember, they was a couple of years ago, 2 or 3 years ago, back in North Carolina, they even talked about a guy saying he saw one that was like a 10-footer, this giant Neanderthal and things like
that. Well,
look.
And that's not the, I've heard several cases of these wild men that live in the Appalachian Mountains there, the Smoky Mountains.
We've discussed. So, is it even any crazier to believe, they believe that they died off 35, 40,000 years ago when the Neanderthals were last, a species, at least. So, okay. Let's be honest with one another. The odds of them making it is slim and none,
of them
something carrying on without there being. But what was it, 13,000 years ago when the Hobbit of Floriensis was still
Homo Floriensis, yeah.
So could there have been, maybe a few more? Maybe there's still some Hobbit people in certain areas. Maybe there's still some Neanderthals in certain areas, small pockets. Like I said, I don't know enough about it. I would say probably not.
I wouldn't believe that there would be. And my thing also is what they saw, was it physical? Or if there could be a ghost of a person, like a woman dies hitchhiking,
a ghost
and then you
of
see the ghost of the woman, why couldn't the same be for Neanderthals? What she saw was a ghost of a Neanderthal.
Yeah, but ghosts don't cook in a cave.
Well, I've heard of smells. When we talked to Joshua Ketchum, they had odors of the supernatural. I don't know.
Anything's possible, I guess.
Yeah.
I mean, but
it's a ghost of a Neanderthal.
It is odd that there's so many stories of these claims in these areas, of these rough, rugged areas of not so much Bigfoot, but Neanderthal. Or Are they Bigfoot? Are they seeing Bigfoot, and that's just how they relate what they're seeing, because they don't have a grasp of what we, how we see it or perceive it here in America.
Yeah.
That's how they perceive it, say, in South America, you know, who knows, where in Russia, who knows? And that's just how their lore, because they don't really have any background to it like that.
Right. Well, speaking of seeing strange things, we've been keeping up with this monster that's being seen in and around Chicago mm-hmm. for the last couple months now. This giant flying humanoid looks like the Jeepers Creepers, this bat-winged thing. Well, Lon Strickley recently posted another sighting over there where a guy had just found out about all these sightings, and it reminded him of something he saw when he was a kid. Now, he wrote into Lon, and this is what he says. He said, almost 30 years ago, when I was a kid, I saw something like this flying humanoid in the night sky in Frankfort, Illinois. Now, Frankfort is about 35 miles south of Chicago, and at the time, it was still a fairly rural area. I remember it being larger than a human and very pterodactyl-like, as some people are describing it. Now, over the years, the memory would pop into my head about once every few years or so, but I've always pawned it off that I was just a kid and that I probably had a vivid imagination and my mind was probably playing tricks on me, being that I was under 10 years old at the time, and a kid's imagination is very strong. I've always been a skeptic of the paranormal and always look for a rational explanation for things just like this. However, when I first saw the article about the sightings on Facebook earlier this year, this childhood memory immediately came to my mind, and I began to again question what it was that I saw. Because as big of a skeptic as I am of things like this, and with the many things that I have found rational explanations for, there are still about 3 or 4 experiences I've had in my life that, try as I may, I still cannot find a rational explanation for. I could still maintain that my childhood imagination got away from me, but I honestly don't think that's the case after hearing about the 2 sightings earlier this year, which is now up to 55 sightings according to the new article on Vice.com. After seeing the first article on Facebook some months ago, I began to think that maybe I really did see this thing. On the other hand, I thought that anybody could write a phony article and put it out on social media, but if that's the case, then it would be an awful big coincidence. A week or two after finding the Facebook article, I told a family member about the article because I once told them about the strange sighting I had as a child. Although the first time I told them of the sighting, I still chalked it up as it was a long time ago and my mind and memory could have been deceiving me. When I told them about the article, they said that they saw a recent report on the news that 2 people claimed to see the same thing, which to me brings a lot more validity to the article I read. From what I remember in my own experience, I was riding in the back seat of my parents' convertible with the top down one summer night. I want to say it was in the late 80s or very early 90s. I was laying down in the back seat just looking up at the night sky. I couldn't have been more than 7 or 8 at the time. We were on the way to the grocery store as my dad worked mostly second and third shifts. So we would sometimes get groceries at night. As we drove down the road, I remember seeing this large black creature swoop past us overhead. From what I remember, it was flying perpendicular to the direction our car was traveling. I don't remember exactly how long it was flying, but it was low enough for me to discern that it was larger than a person, and it had an enormous wingspan. It was soaring open-winged like a hawk would fly. It balanced with the night sky pretty well and was directly above and perpendicular to the car, so I was the only one in the car who saw it. When I originally told my parents about it years later, they said they don't remember that happening at all, so I assume they did not see it, as they were looking at the road, and I was looking up into the sky. I don't remember being startled by it, and I know I did not make any noise or scream because my parents do not recall the experience at all. I remember being intrigued by it because I was into dinosaurs as a kid, and it very much reminded me of a pterodactyl. I was old enough to know it's not something you see every day, but still young enough not to question whether or not something like that should exist. I had no concept yet of what the paranormal was, and therefore was not scared of it. Again, I am a very rational person, and always look for a logical explanation with things like this. I'm not saying that it did happen for certain. There is still a chance that I could have just imagined the whole thing. Maybe my mind is just reconstructing an old memory of what I thought I saw as a wildly imaginative kid. However, since seeing that first article and hearing about the other people's accounts of it and reports of it on the evening news, I'm leaning more towards that my memory serves me correctly on this one. Ever since then, I've felt a compelling urge to reach out and tell someone that I think I saw the same thing too. This is my reason for contacting you, because you are collecting accounts of this creature being sighted, and I wanted to see who else has seen this thing, and maybe we could all feel less crazy about what we saw. So what do you think of that? I mean, that's pretty interesting, because the guy's like, he kind of thought about it. You know, it happens to everybody. You have a memory or of something, and you just kind of forget about it, and then one day, it just something happens, and it jars your memory, and he's like, what? This has been going on?
Yeah.
And it's in the same area? I mean, there's been up to 55 sightings now.
And even
the local news has reported on it, not just the paper, I'm talking like television. So, I mean, can that many people really be making something up?
I don't see how, but it still does seem like we talked about when we start discussing thought forms and people, as it starts snowballing, you know, I don't know, man. That's one of those things that this is the prime example, is we have all these sightings in a certain area, in a town that's easily accessible. And nobody's up there putting in a bunch of work to try to find it to get any answers.
Yeah.
So that being said, you're like, I don't know. Or are they? Did people go up there and put in a lot of work and a lot of hours and it just didn't come back the way they wanted? I don't, man, it doesn't make sense, because it can't be a flesh and blood thing as we understand them now. If it is, it's something that's not of this earth, flesh and blood, like it got here in some other form or fashion.
Yeah.
Like it's not something in our fossil record that shows that.
It's insane, and I'm going to keep my eye out and keep looking up whenever I'm in that area, because I want to know what's going on in and around the city of Chicago.
Yeah, it'd be
but,
cool.
But speaking of the strange and mysterious, on the last Elite show, you were talking about the missing Brandons, which is a very exciting and interesting story about two missing people that I was unaware of. So it got me thinking about missing people and people that have vanished into thin air. And it reminded me of the story I'm going to do today. So let's take a break, folks. When we get back from the break, I'm going to be talking about the strange vanishing of Keith Reinhard. You're listening to Expanded Perspectives. On the last Expanded Perspectives Elite Show, Cam brought up some very unusual disappearances, simply known as the Missing Brandons, a case where two young men disappeared under bizarre circumstances that even to this day, no one knows what really happened. They've never resurfaced, their remains never discovered. So, after the show, I really got to thinking about other strange disappearances that I've read about over the years. I've read all of David Politis's books, Missing 411, and I'm a big fan of the genre. He, too, mentions hundreds of strange disappearances of individuals in our nation's national parks, with little or no evidence ever found. The people, for whatever reason, simply vanish into thin air. Oftentimes, they disappear just before the beginning of a thunderstorm or blizzard, making tracking them even more difficult. Items of their clothing are discarded, especially shoes and socks, and even more disturbing, if they possessed any weapons of any kind, like knives, bows, or firearms, those are left behind too. Even odder, many of the victims, if found, were discovered miles away from where they should have been, and, if in a mountainous area, they, for whatever reason, ascend rather than descend up the mountains. That's not natural. If you're lost and you need to get back to civilization, you know to go downhill to where all the towns are, and you know not to leave your weapons, clothes, and shoes behind. In some of the cases, the missing people are found alive. When found, they are in some sort of weird trance. They don't know where they are, what they are doing, and what happened to them and their stuff. In the cases involving children, they talk about a bear taking care of them and keeping them warm throughout the night. Now, is this real, or just a hallucination brought on by the stress and the cold of the environment, and the child is imagining this unseen protector? I don't know, but it is fascinating. In one particular case, David tells the story of a 2-year-old boy who was suddenly lost by his parents. He was there with them, only a few yards away, playing, and the next moment, he was gone. Search and rescue teams were called in, and they looked for him for 2 days before they finally found him alive, 12 miles away, up a large hill, where he would have needed to cross 2 rivers and a fence to get where he was finally discovered, a seemingly impossible task for a 2-year-old to do. I don't think a 2-year-old could cover a distance of 12 miles on flat land in the best of weather conditions, yet it happened. So, it appears that all things aren't what we think they are when it comes to the forest and the mountains. Well, as I drove home from the studio, thinking about people vanishing, I suddenly remembered another strange case of a man who went off to seek a new life in a rural locale, only to become obsessed with a strange disappearance himself. Then, he actually started writing a book about it because he was an author, and then wound up vanishing himself. Like something out of a Stephen King novel, the story itself seems impossible. But like so many other things that seem impossible that we discuss each and every week on this show, this one only leaves you with more questions than answers. The story takes place in a small mountain town in Colorado known as Silver Plume. This tiny scenic town is located about 58 miles west of Denver, Colorado, and is situated along the Clear Creek in the Front Range of the Rocky Mountains. Now, this small town is very small, and when I mean small, I'm talking about a population of roughly 200 people. It can swell to a little over 300 people during peak tourist periods, usually during the spring and summer. People usually drive out to Silver Plume to escape the hustle and bustle of city life in Denver. You know, for the clean mountain air, the scenic landscape, to tour the little gift shops and hike the many trails in and around the town. It was originally founded in 1864. It was originally meant to be a gold camp, but instead of gold, all anyone could find were large amounts of clumps of worthless grayish rock, which the frustrated miners at the time discarded in their hunt for gold. Well, at some point, it was figured out that that junk rock that was all over the place was actually silver ore, which proved to be a jackpot for the town since the monetary system of the day was based on a bimetal standard of both gold and silver. Indeed, the name Silver Plume comes from the vast amounts of silver ore that were said to be found there in abundance. When the devastating major economic depression, known as the Panic of 1893, hit the United States, the government switched from a bimetal standard to an all-gold one, which sent the value of silver plummeting and spelled the end of the town of Silver Plume. So, at this point, many people packed up and left, leaving only the creepy remains of many of the old buildings and shops behind. But the town lived on. Of course, only a shell of what it once was. For many years, the town was known as a semi-ghost town, or a living ghost town, and it wasn't long before people began visiting Silver Plume for an entirely different reason altogether. For whatever reason, some people seemed to enjoy visiting old, worn-down western towns, and the town began a small rebound. At some point, this is the very spot that a man named Keith Reinhard came to try to start a new life. The soon-to-be 50-year-old sports writer for the Chicago Daily Herald had been in somewhat of a slump in his life. He was stressed from the big city life he was living, gaining weight, losing focus on his writing, and generally becoming increasingly disillusioned about where his life was headed. He felt like he was stuck in a rut, and he needed to try to find a way out. He had a good job and a loving wife of 2 years named Carolyn, but he felt that something was desperately missing, and he yearned to try to turn over a new leaf somewhere far from the hectic city. Keith and his wife, Carolyn, took a trip to Denver one summer, and they decided to do some day tripping, driving around some of the smaller towns on the outskirts of Denver. They would pack a lunch, do some hiking, do some window shopping, and just enjoy the summer days away from the city of Chicago. One day, while driving around, they slipped into the town of Silver Plume. Keith instantly loved it. He loved everything about it. He was tired of big city life, his cubicle job, his daily grind, and knew he needed something different. It was at the peak of this midlife crisis of sorts that Reinhard started daydreaming about moving away to Silver Plume. His longtime good friend, Ted Parker, already lived there, and he was jealous of the slow-paced, quiet life his friend enjoyed there. Reinhard made up his mind to take a 90-day leave of absence from work to get away from it all and to try out living there for a while on his own. He explained to his wife, Carolyn, that he wanted to open an antique shop there, work on fulfilling his dream of writing a novel in peace and quiet, and find direction in his life, with the idea that they could both live there together permanently if everything worked out. Although Carolyn was more than a little skeptical and worried about the whole dramatic idea, she decided to go along with her husband's crazy, idyllic dream. Reinhard moved out to Silver Plume in the summer of 1988 to start his great adventure, along with a profound sense of excitement and high hopes for his future. This was his chance, maybe his last chance, to really do something that he enjoyed. Sure, he was leaving behind a good job with the Daily Herald, a good pension and all, but money isn't everything, and Keith couldn't bear finishing out the rest of his career working as a sports writer. He needed something more fulfilling. He rented a simple storefront from his friend Parker on the town's main street for his antique business and set to work on what he was sure would be his great American novel. Unfortunately, in such a sparsely populated town, there was little business at his shop, even during the peak summer tourist season, and he also began experiencing writer's block on his new book. With inspiration drying up to prove just as elusive out in the fresh air and quaint nature of Silver Plume as it had been in the churning, crowded city of Chicago, his dream of starting anew and finding himself in a small town, life was proving to be no match for the crushing reality. Once again, he was stuck. He couldn't figure out what to write about. He needed something to inspire him. But what? He didn't know. Just about the only thing he found himself enjoying there were his regular hikes out in the rugged nature of the area, surrounded by the crisp, clean, Rocky Mountain air. It was during this time that he became rather intrigued with his storefront's previous owner, a man named Tom Young. The previous year, before Reinhard had rented the space, Young had owned a bookstore there. But then, on September 7, 1987, he suddenly told his friends and family that he was traveling to Europe for a vacation, after which he simply vanished off the face of the earth. He was last seen walking off with his beloved dog, Gus, with which he was said to be inseparable, and no one had seen him since. Indeed, no trace of the missing man or his dog had ever been found, despite intensive searches of the area. Enthralled by this odd mystery, which had happened right there, in his newfound town, with a man who had rented the very same shop, Reinhard began asking his good friend Ted Parker about it, and then going out into town to extensively interview locals about Tom Young and the strange disappearance, taking meticulous, detailed notes the entire time. As Reinhard became more and more obsessed with the mystery of Tom Young's mysterious disappearance, he began to gain inspiration, and it finally dawned on him. That's it. In a eureka moment, Keith realized that this is what he should write his novel about. His new book could feature a character that was a composite of Tom Young and himself. Of course, change the names and of the town and the people, but still it gave him a perfect backdrop for his new masterpiece. After a period of his stalled first book idea and almost giving up on writing at all, he had finally found his muse. Reinhard would begin to spend all of his free time poring over his notes and information on Tom Young and the strange vanishing, as well as feverishly writing away on his novel at what is said all hours of the night, powered and invigorated by his newfound inspiration and passion to write. It was during this writing spree and obsession with Young that a break would be made in the case of the strange disappearance. On July 31st, 1988, some local hunters found the skeletal remains of a long-lost Tom Young, propped up against a tree out in the woods about an hour from Silver Plume and with a bullet hole in his head. Not far from Young's body was a pistol, a backpack, and the missing dog, Gus, also with a bullet hole to the head. It was later found that Young had purchased the pistol just 4 days before his disappearance. As far as the authorities were concerned, it was a straightforward suicide, with Young taking his beloved pet with him. But many of the locals still suspected some sort of foul play, insisting that Young, well, he might commit suicide, but he would never hurt that dog. Although the mysterious vanishing had been in a way solved, the police considered the cold case closed. The mystery was still kept alive, though, for many of the people in the town. Small towns are like that, I guess. Well, I don't guess, I know. I'm from a small town myself. Everyone knows everyone else, and Silver Plume was no different. This is where the story gets strange. About a week later, on August 7th, 1988, Keith Reinhard closed up his shop as usual and casually told his friends that he had decided to go hiking up on the nearby Pendleton Mountain. Now, at the time, everyone thought it was just a joke, as it was after 4 in the afternoon, and hiking up the mountain would take at least 6 hours round trip. In addition, he was gearing up to leave with just the clothes he had on and no additional supplies whatsoever, or even the appropriate clothing for the cold temperatures up on the mountain. Adding to the oddness was that he had apparently tried to hike the mountain before, but had turned back early due to his fear of heights and the strenuous difficulty of the terrain. Even his best friend in the town, Ted Parker, thought he was just messing around when he came to his cafe to tell him of his plans. Parker would later tell local authorities, "He was in the cafe, and he told me he was going to make it to the top of the mountain. If I don't come back, call on the search and rescue," he said. That in jest, I felt. "I have this picture of him pointing to the mountain and saying goodbye. That was the last time I ever saw him." Despite absolutely no one taking him seriously about his plans, at 4:30 p.m., Keith Reinhard was seen walking off towards the looming mountain with not so much as a backpack. He wasn't even wearing a warm jacket. He would never be seen again. He had said he would be back by 10 p.m., but that time came and went without any sign of Reinhard. When the next morning arrived and Reinhard had still not returned, a massive search was launched of the area, which would involve hundreds of people, airplanes, helicopters, and trained dogs scourging a large section of the difficult terrain for a week without finding a shred of evidence of what had happened to him. At the time, it was the largest rescue operation in Colorado history, yet it turned up nothing. The frustrated head of the rescue team, a man named Charlie Szymanski, would say of the situation, "The Reinhard search was like looking for the proverbial needle in a haystack. This haystack is 3,000 vertical feet of 60-degree slope. This was about as difficult a search of terrain as we can cover. We are at a real disadvantage because Keith went into the mountains wearing no more than blue jeans and a flannel shirt and some tennis shoes. He had no backpack. He had no equipment. A typical subject of a search will leave lots of clues for us to trace. Keith didn't leave any clues at all. He didn't have many with him to leave behind." The search was finally called off on August 12th after a Cessna aircraft carrying two rescuers accidentally crashed, killing one of them and seriously injuring the other. Reinhard remained missing, with not a single trace of him ever being discovered. The only clue left behind was a curious passage found by his friends on his computer that seemed to be part of the novel that he had been working on, and then one that he would never finish. The strange passage concerns the main character, which had been given the name Guy Gypsum. Now the passage says, Guy Gypsum changed into some hiking boots and donned a heavy flannel shirt. He understood it all now, and his motivation. Guy closed the door, then walked off towards the lush, shadowless Colorado forest above. Those are apparently the last words Reinhard would ever write, the abrupt end to his novel. In the years since Keith Reinhard's mysterious disappearance, there have been many theories proposed as to what happened to him. One theory is that Reinhard was trying to emulate the adventurous character of his own novel, Guy Gypsum, and that he had gone off to get a feel for it, but with every intention of coming back to write more. Finish that last passage, perhaps, and had gotten lost or possibly injured in the raw, unforgiving landscape, or succumbed to the elements and suffered from hypothermia. It is quite possible that he would want to try and step in his character's shoes to spur on his writing. And when asked about it, Reinhard's own daughter, Tiffany, would say, "Writers like to live the story they're writing about. I like to get a feel of it, so it's easier for them to write about. Maybe my father, it's always possible, wanted to feel what it's like to disappear, so he could write about it in his book." Another theory is that he had gone off to the mountain with no intention of ever returning, perhaps planning to vanish or even die the same way that Tom Young had. But there's no evidence that he ever owned a gun. And furthermore, he had not mentioned any desire to die, and according to his family and friends, he had not been suicidal in the slightest bit. He was always described by his friends and family as a reasonably happy person who cherished his loved ones and would never wish to take his own life. He had a happy marriage, and with his new book almost complete, he was very upbeat and high on life. Another idea is that he had just set out for a simple hike, as he often did, perhaps not even really intending to go up on Pendleton Mountain at all, but he just told people that. Even with a short distance hike, the terrain here is rugged and treacherous, and he could have easily fallen, gotten injured somehow, or met with any number of perils out there. He also might have just wanted to disappear for a short while to see how everyone reacted, either as a joke or for some research for his book, and then either met with some unexpected accident out in the wilds and died, or felt guilty that someone had died looking for him, causing him to remain in hiding. In yet another possible theory, it has been speculated that perhaps he was running from something unknown to his family, or even someone. Alleged sightings of Reinhard over the years in various places have fueled this theory, but authorities have mostly dismissed these accounts. You have to admit, it is a bit strange that an up-and-coming author moves from the big city to start a new life, ends up renting a storefront whose prior owner just up and vanished. Then, because he was so intrigued by his story that he decides to write a novel loosely based on that person to eventually disappear himself. I mean, what are the chances? For some, it means that both Young and Reinhard found something in that shop that they weren't meant to see and were subsequently murdered for it. For others, the timing of Reinhard's disappearance just 1 week after the macabre discovery of Young's body means that perhaps Reinhard, with all of his detailed research on Young, had found some new evidence and that the man had met with foul play, evidence that would get him silenced. For still others, all of the coincidences equate to some paranormal synchronicity, but I don't know. The whole strange mystery of Keith Reinhard has been picked apart and debated for years, and it has spawned a documentary called Dark Side of the Mountain and has been featured on an episode of the TV series Unsolved Mysteries back on January 31st, 1990. It's not difficult to see why the colorfully bizarre disappearance of Keith Reinhard has drawn to itself so much scrutiny. It is such an enthralling mystery that captures one's imagination. There is a certain macabre allure to the whole thing. Unfortunately, this means that many elements to the case have been changed or exaggerated over the years through numerous retellings and countless articles on the matter, to the point that a detective, Dave Dauenhauer, of the Clear Creek County Sheriff's Department, once told a reporter, "What happened to Keith Reinhard and Tom Young has been knocked around and embellished so much, it's hard to know where the truth ends and the glamorization begins. So, what in the world happened to Keith Reinhard? Was he simply out in the field, trying to get some sort of first-hand experience for his character to add to his book, and then something bad happened? He slipped, perhaps broke his back or legs, and couldn't make it back home. Or, during his obsession with Tom Young, did the line between fantasy and reality completely disappear? And in some sick way, he was determined to become Tom and headed out into the wild to become his new character, Guy Gypsum. Or was it truly foul play? Did he find something in his store that he wasn't supposed to? Did Tom Young find the same thing? One can only wonder. Or, finally, is it one gigantic coincidence, an incredible synchronicity, that a young man goes missing and another man becomes obsessed with his case and then eventually goes missing himself? I don't know. I wish I did know. Certainly the families involved wish to know. Perhaps he did make an escape and is living his life with an alias in some faraway land. Thailand, perhaps. Maybe now he's practicing Muay Thai. Or is a fisherman off the coast of Argentina. Who knows? Maybe like so many others, he accidentally slipped into some sort of portal up on that mountain and is now in a totally different dimension. Most likely, he's dead and his body is still somewhere up on that mountain. But in the end, it's up to you to decide. You're listening to Expanded Perspectives. We're back with Expanded Perspectives. It's a very strange story. It seems like an episode of The Twilight Zone or something that Stephen King would write, but this is actually a real story, and it's kind of crazy. I mean, the guy becomes interested in someone that goes missing, mm-hmm. and then he himself ends up going missing. Very bizarre. I don't know what to think about that. But before we went to the segment part of the show, I was reading this story of the guy that remembered a strange sighting of this bat-like creature in Chicago or near Chicago that so many people have seen. And it reminded me of a recent email we got. And let me pull it up here and read this to you. And this comes from someone named Catherine. And it's pretty interesting. She says, "Hello, guys. I've been listening to your podcast for quite some time, although you've said in your latest free show, A Line Not to Be Crossed, that you have repeatedly mentioned a bat-like creature that has been spotted near Chicago. This is the first that I've heard about it. I think I might be able to chime in on this topic, though. I live south of Chicago, have most of my life. I've also been dating a girl from the suburbs for a bit over a year now, and a few months back, she was staying at her parents' house for a while, and I came to visit. Now, her parents are super religious, but accepting of our gay relationship. Still, they would not ever accept me staying the night. So, I stayed with her as long as I could before I had to leave for the evening. It was about 1 a.m., and I was just south of Lamont, Illinois, about to get onto I-55. That's when I saw a figure at the side of the road, leaning over a carcass, a large roadkill of some kind, maybe even a deer. I think it heard my car coming, and it suddenly shot up, looked back over its shoulders towards me. I could see a bit of eyes reflecting some light, much like you hear in all those stories about those mysterious creatures with glowing eyes. Then it fluttered its wings and made itself as large as it could, taking an aggressive stance. I can only assume it was trying to scare me away from its meal. It was absolutely huge, maybe only a few feet tall, but an impressive 7-foot wingspan. I could be lying if I said it didn't startle me a bit. It was an owl. Maybe the biggest I've ever seen by far, but it was an owl. Right up until it fluttered its feathers, it looked so much stranger. It's funny how something can look almost alien when they aren't all puffed up. Perhaps this is what people are seeing, and in that instant, it sure was intimidating, and many people around the city don't expect to see owls there. Make no mistake, they are everywhere and can catch you by surprise in the dark. Anyways, thanks for the entertainment, guys. Please keep up the good work. So, I have to agree with her. If you're not super familiar with what an owl looks mm-hmm. like, you could easily, in the dark, say, oh, that thing was much taller than that. It was 7 foot tall.
Yeah.
Or if she hadn't have looked at it so intently when it just shot up and didn't really look to see it when it fluttered its wings. I mean, she didn't think it was an owl originally.
That's true.
I wonder if some, you know, I'm not saying all of the sightings,
yeah.
but maybe some of the sightings are. There's just a large owl on the loose around there. Maybe somebody bought an exotic pet, you know, like a harpy eagle. It's not native to that area, but maybe somebody bought one on the black market. You hear about this stuff all the time.
Yeah.
You know, so I'm thinking some drug dealer there in Chirac, you know, he's got him a big harpy eagle or a condor as a pet. And then the thing got loose one night.
Showing off.
Yeah, so now it still flies around the suburbs and people aren't used to seeing something that large. So they're like, oh yeah, there's this giant bat-winged creature. When in fact, it's just a large predator. A large bird of prey that is just not normal for that area. I don't know.
Well, I guess, I mean, of course there could be.
Yeah, well, of course.
But to me, that explanation is even more crazy than the explanation of there being a giant mothman.
So you think it's much more likely there's a giant bat-winged Jeepers Creepers humanoid than there is the chance that a
cash money millionaire
a loped-out drug dealer didn't buy a pet condor or a harpy eagle yeah. and just lost it. Yeah, now that's ridiculous.
It. Yeah, that's too much. What, too much?
Yeah.
You know what? I do agree with you. Is if you're not prepared for that, if you don't expect it, if you haven't seen one, yeah. if it's all nude. And
lots of times people are driving down the road, so you only have a few seconds.
Yeah.
And it's dark.
I can understand it. And, you know, and also, too, we don't know if anybody had been drinking or they hadn't. You know, there's all this what ifs and speculation, all that stuff. I get it. But also, I don't believe that everybody is seeing an owl and mistaking them for what they're claiming they are seeing.
Well, certainly
last I checked, owls didn't have glowing red eyes. I'm just throwing that out there.
Well,
you're not right. The owls that I've seen anyway.
No,
and I've seen several. So I don't know, man. It's one.
But you do know, after spending a lot of time in the woods, there's plenty of times where it's morning hunt. It's dark out. You arrive in the stand before the morning hunt. You think you see something, and then as it gets more light, then you're like, oh.
It's a bush.
That was a stump.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. So, that's happened a lot.
Yeah. So, like, say you've been reading these spooky stories at night.
Especially if you want to see it.
So, I'm saying it's in your back of your brain because you've read about it. You're a big fan of Phantoms and Monsters or something. You watched Viceland the other day, and then you're bebopping around walking your dog in a park, and all of a sudden a giant owl flies out. You might be like, I saw it.
Somebody slinging the devil's dandruff got their condor got loose and that comes sweeping through the park.
I still say it's possible.
I like,
you know,
the
drug dealers. They're like, for whatever, they're like, you've read about the guys in Brooklyn that have a pet tiger in their apartment. They got a pet crocodile in their apartment.
Yeah.
You see Pablo Escobar's got hippos. I mean, I don't know for what it is. You know, at some point, jewelry's just not enough to brag anymore. You got to get an exotic pets.
You got to get a condor and harpy eagle.
Right? No, this is my pet Gaboon viper. You know, I just can't have just a boa constrictor. That's weak.
That's weak.
I got to have one of the most deadly snakes you can get. That's an inland taipan. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. That. Yeah.
That's
I'm
how
down.
You ball. That's how you flex.
That's how you're balling
that's
out of control.
That's how you floss. Yeah.
That's right. My wrist is froze.
Yeah, I think that's what it is.
I'm going with your whole explanation. I'm down with that. I'm digging that. I'll tell you something else that I'm digging while we're talking about digging on things. On Facebook, I posted about YouTube, about us starting that new YouTube channel last week. And
that's right, yep.
People didn't let down. There was a ton of stuff. We got a bunch of messages on Facebook. A bunch of people posted on Facebook, a bunch of emails about it, a bunch of DMs. Somebody was sliding in our DMs on Instagram.
Yeah.
We got a lot of stuff about it, and I think we've chosen one.
What's it going to be?
David Oswalt got a lot of love on Facebook from it, and I'm going with it. Expanded Adventures is going to be the second YouTube page.
That is a good name, although I do think here, we should name a few episodes.
Here it comes. I know exactly. Let me get their name. I know exactly what you're talking about here. Walter Whitaker.
Yeah,
Walter Whitaker's got the one that Kyle wants. Cam and Kyle's Excellent Outdoor Adventures.
Yeah, that's a good one. I'm not saying we're going to name the channel that, but I think we should start a series like we tried with, what was it, Unusual Encounters?
Yeah.
Which was a big fail.
Yeah.
What, did we make one?
Yeah, I think we made one. We filmed several, but the rest of them were like, no, those aren't good.
You're like, oh, man, we're going to do this. I'm going to do that. Yeah, it's going to be awesome.
Once we did it, we're like, we don't like that.
And then once you start doing it, you're like... Mm-mm. Well, do you want to do the podcast this week or Unusual Encounters? Because I don't think we have enough time to do all three.
That's right. That's right.
You know, so it's one of those deals. But yeah, I think we should definitely name a few segments. Kyle and Cam's Excellent Outdoor Adventures. That's pretty cool.
I guess we could sprinkle in Unusual Encounters every now and again while we're doing some filming and monkeying around. But yeah, for sure, it is. There's going to be Cam and Kyle's Excellent Outdoor Adventures. That is for sure going to happen.
Yeah, I'm excited about it.
Yeah, Expanded Adventures is jam up. That's what we're going to go with. Also... A big thanks to Alex from Indica Roots. We're talking about him. Next thing I know, bingo, we got t-shirts. We got some stickers. We got all kinds of good stuff. CDs.
Yeah, man.
We'd be jamming on it, too. Yeah, trust me. We've been jamming on it like crazy.
I really liked it. Well, if you like Expanded Perspectives, don't forget there's Expanded Perspectives Elite. If you like this show and listen to the show, you're only enjoying 50% of our work. You can join Expanded Perspectives Elite and get an additional show every week, as well as access to the entire back catalog. And we really appreciate our elite members because their monthly support helps us to buy new books, magazines, things like that. Because you can imagine it gets very difficult trying to come up with a topic twice a week, every week, whenever you're doing it almost 5 years.
Yeah.
And so a lot of the places we get some of the stories is from books.
Yeah.
And so it helps out a lot for us to be able to write those books. Also, I totally understand if you don't have the money to become an elite member, but if you still want to support the show, the best possible way you could do that would be, it takes no money at all, is to write us a review. It only takes a few minutes of your time. Doesn't cost you a dime. Takes 3 minutes out of your day to write us a review. And by you writing us a review, it keeps us higher up in the search list on iTunes, which in turn causes more people to listen to the show, which in turn causes more sponsors to sponsor the show. So by proxy, you're actually helping us gain dollars to buy more books.
That's true. Yeah.
We're up to like 742 here in the States. We're trying to get to 1,000 before the year's over. So if you haven't,
I don't
already
know about that. We need to go back. Look.
Right? We need reviews.
I'm doing right now, but I'm leaving it up to you. We're starting to have to go through the other countries, too.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah.
I'm still going to stick here in the U.S. I'll get some other countries next week. I'm going to go with Saber5150.
Thank you.
Nikki Wonkenstein.
Thanks.
Shadow Fox. Monkey Man Junk Metal Dude.
Nice.
Celtic Rider. Let's see. Queen Mummy and You. Rocky Vanren. Toggies, W. Dinert, Balsall, Izzy iTunes, and Isabella 841. Thank y'all.
Yeah, thank you
so much. Now, next week, I'll get over into April of 2017, and we'll work our way through all that. If we've missed y'all, and y'all were back, I'm super duper sorry. If you want to get on the list, just write another one. We'll put you on the list.
Yeah, right? No, it really does. Like, when people are searching for, like, when you look at the top charts on iTunes, that's one of the ways in the algorithm that puts you on the top part of that list is people that subscribe to that show that week, people that write reviews for that show that week, and for new listeners and stuff like that. So like we're saying, if you can keep getting those reviews to come in, stuff like that, it actually does help us get noticed, because lots of times when people are looking for a paranormal show to listen to, what do? You kind of look at the top 25 and then you kind of lose interest.
Yeah.
You're not going to go digging deep.
Deep.
300 shows in. So luckily, we're always in the top 20 in our category.
Yeah.
Which is philosophy. And I think with our artwork, people are kind of drawn to it. But it helps us out. And we really appreciate it. Cam, I know you your wife's out of town, so you're on your own this week. You've been staying out of trouble?
I've been trying to stay out of trouble. I've been busy. In fact, I had to call the bank today because my wife forgot to tell them she was going to be out of the country.
Oh, no.
Yeah, so she's like, what if I... And luckily, I don't know how she did it, but she got a message to me. And she's like, you got to call them. I forgot to. So I had to touch base with that. But y'all know how this stuff is. Things like that go on. So, I mean, it is what it is. But for me, I've been doing some cooking, doing some just monkeying around the house, working on videos, just pretty much hanging out. And my daughter and I have been watching shows and laughing. She is... She's got a hilarious sense of humor. So her and I have been cackling. I've been cackling listening to that whole thing.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. She's something else.
My week is work as normal, except we are starting baseball. So Jacob's first practice with his new travel team starts this week. I'm excited about the upcoming season. Spring is always the best. I like the weather. I like the team sport itself. I like working out with the kids because I get to throw the ball and run around too, like a big kid. And so I'm looking forward to that. He's looking forward to it too. But outside of that, I'm just trying to knock this work out so we can go on vacation. We're going to be going snow skiing and snowboarding soon up in Colorado. So I'm looking forward to that. And I've been seeing where we're going. They're getting a lot of snow. So I'm excited.
I'm down.
Right?
I'm down. We're going to be doing some filming there for sure.
Mm-hmm.
Talking and stuff and going with that whole deal there. So yeah, we'll do some filming and the whole thing. So yeah, it'll be fun. We'll get it popped up there.
Everybody have a good week. Don't work too hard for you. Elite members will be talking to you later this week. For everybody else, we'll talk to you next Monday. For Pretty Lights, Inner Tradition Books, New Page Books, Llewellyn Books, Anomalous Books, and Ancient American Magazine. Till next time, I'm Kyle Filson. He's Cam Hale.
Peace, y'all.